What is an effects chain, and does the order of plugins and effects in your signal chain matter? In this video, we will demystify setting up a signal chain that will get your tracks sounding great in the simplest and easiest way possible. And stick around for later on in the video for the age-old debate: do you put EQ or compressor first in your signal chain? So get your free trials of Neutron 4 and Nectar 4 via the links in the description box below, and let's get into this video. Effect chain presets can help you understand typical signal processing chains, and you can see how each module feeds into each other and affects the final sound. Nectar 4 and Neutron 4 both have assistant features that can help you set up signal chains that are tailored to your desired sound or references, which can also be captured via audio lens. And because the complete effect chain is built within the plugin, you can easily move the modules around to see how that will affect the final sound. There is no need to overcomplicate things. Using presets can help you achieve the sound that you're looking for quicker, and then with a few simple tweaks, you can speed up your workflow and move on to the next elements in your mix. Not to mention that when you've found effects chains that you really like, you can save them for a quick recall as your own presets, and that way start to craft your own signature sound. Okay, presets aside, how do you actually create an effects chain from scratch? Well, there's no right or wrong here. It will all depend on what serves the track best and your overall vision. So we would always recommend getting to know the track first. And while you're listening, try to identify which methods and effects processing chains could help you achieve the vision that you or the artist are looking for. This very simple method of taking some time to get to know the track initially will help to keep you focused and prevent you from aimlessly applying different plugins and then having to fight against your own processing choices later down the line. Some elements of your mix might just require really simple corrective moves, and others will require more processing, including lush creative effects that might require some more experimentation. Having discernment on what serves the track best is key to a great sounding mix and a successful effects chain. Another tip to keep in mind as we go forward is gain staging throughout your effects chain. Some effects can boost the level of your signal, and you want to avoid clipping as it goes into the next module and so on. A pretty simple workflow to follow when crafting your effects chain is to tackle corrective moves first. Typically, we might start with an EQ, and instead of boosting frequencies, we'd be looking at cutting unwanted frequencies instead. So this could look like applying a high-pass filter to eliminate some low-end rumble. It could be attenuating muddy or boxy frequencies, and so on. The reason we do this is that when we apply compression and other effects later on in the chain, these unwanted frequencies can be emphasized even more. Next, we might want to focus on more tonal and shaping moves. So this could mean evening out the dynamics with a compressor, or shaping the dynamics with a compressor by adding more weight to drums, for example. We might add another EQ to boost certain frequencies, or even use analog EQ emulations for some added harmonics and tonal qualities. Further, we can focus on more creative effects that will help you achieve the sound that you're looking for. So this could be saturation, distortion, modulation, as well as time-based effects like reverb and delay. You might also want to look at different ways of setting up your effects chains, either directly on the channel or with a send and return method, where you can set the processing to 100% wet, and that way you can send multiple elements to that one channel that will save on your CPU processing. You can also manipulate how much of each of these elements are affected by the effects chain, and you can automate your sends for some added excitement throughout your mix. But first, let's answer this age-old question. In the analog console days, most effects chains were laid out with the EQ first, followed by compression. Today, a lot of mixing is done in the box, which allows us to easily experiment with the order in which we compress or EQ. EQ and compression have the potential to manipulate the level or volume of the sound, but the way in which they do that is very different. EQ allows the engineer to boost or cut certain frequencies to fix a problem or change the color of the sound. Compression changes the relationship between the loudest and quietest parts of your signal by bringing those differences in level closer together. When you place both EQ and compression, both of which have the potential to manipulate the level, whichever plugin comes first will then affect the sound you can achieve with the plugins that follow. When considering EQ and compression, it's important to note that a compressor will generate added harmonics. This might mean if you've placed an EQ in your chain first, followed by a compressor, you might want to EQ your signal again to either boost or attenuate those harmonics. Here, Insight shows us the harmonics created by a compressor. When compression is used before EQ, some of the compression is undone when we boost the frequencies with EQ. This is because the boosted band of frequencies can be louder than what the compressor would have allowed, or then frequencies outside the boosted range. The argument for using compression before EQ is that if you're gonna have to use the EQ again after compression, why not just start with the compression and then EQ afterwards and call it a day? Well, if there are technical issues that can be corrected with EQ, such as low-end thumps, for example, it's best to correct them before applying more processing, as they can cause the compressor to react in undesirable ways. Typically, an EQ before a compressor does a more technical job than a creative one, such as improving clarity or presence. The EQ modifies the degree and focus of the compressor, while a compressor tames the EQ curve that came before it. The compressor will kick in as soon as the signal's level hits the threshold, so leaving unwanted frequencies in or creating really dramatic boosts with an EQ could mean that a threshold is met at a different level than it otherwise would have been without the EQ that came before it. This could cause the compressor to lower the level in response or change the way that it reacts to the signal. This is why many engineers recommend a corrective EQ before a compressor, and then later on in your chain you can boost certain frequencies, you can apply more tonal EQs and compressors to shape and color the sound further. However, if there is nothing to attenuate or correct, you can also just reach for a compressor first. Remember, there is no right or wrong here, and ultimately you have to trust your ears, so let's take a listen to a couple examples. Here I am applying corrective EQ before compression, and I'm also just going to turn the EQ off so you can hear the difference that it makes to the compressed signal.
And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want. And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want.
Next, let's try boosting the EQ before compression. Notice how the signal sounds less EQ'd after the compressor.
And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want.
And now let's switch these modules around.
And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want.
Okay, now that we have the basics out of the way, let's put it into practice and set up a basic vocal chain. Here, I'm starting with corrective EQ. In Nectar 4, I can choose between different EQ nodes to best serve the purpose from just the EQ module alone. I'm scooping out some unnecessary low end rumble with a high pass filter, and then I am simply sweeping through the rest of my frequency range to find boxy or muddy frequencies and simply attenuating them. Next, some compression to help me smooth out the dynamics and maintain a clear, intelligible sound throughout. I may choose to add another tonal compressor, for example, the optical compressor, and I can use this in parallel or just as a second compressor in my chain, adding more tonal qualities and further shaping the dynamics of my vocal. After compression, there are some frequencies that I want to boost with an EQ for excitement and intelligibility. I might also add some brightness and air to my vocals with an analog EQ node to further excite those harmonics. And I'm also adding a de-esser to smooth out the consonants without removing that brightness that I'm trying to add into my vocal chain. Next, we're adding some saturation, which I can use directly on my vocal or in parallel by adjusting the mix slider. And finally, some time-based effects with reverb and delay. I can also shape the sound of these effects with an EQ.
And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want. And hold on, been going round and round in circles. Are we gonna ever solve this riddle? But wait and come back. You've got my heart right there with you, but I'm not the one you want.
I could also play around with my effects chain further by adding some dimension, doubling effects, the Nectar 4 voices module to thicken out my vocal arrangement and add a more modern creative sound. Now, as you continue to explore different signal chains, you will quickly notice that a lot of those choices will be purpose-driven, and you will learn to pick up certain moves and tricks depending on the sounds you're working with through practice and experimentation. For example, in a mastering chain, you would be looking at enhancing an existing mix, as well as having to meet specific technical guidelines for CD, streaming, vinyl, and you have to ensure that your master meets the appropriate levels and requirements and translates well through any medium. Your guitar signal chain might also be quite different from a vocal chain, with ample amounts of amps and guitar pedals to experiment with. So we would highly recommend exploring the signal chains available in Guitar Rig 7 and the effects that we have on board there to better understand how some of those effects chains are crafted. And those effects can also be used for instruments and vocals and in many different creative applications. At iZotope, we have more videos and blogs to explore, so check the links in the description box below for more useful tools and tips. As always, thank you so much for watching this video and I hope you found it helpful. Please drop any questions or comments below and subscribe to iZotope YouTube for more mixing and production tips and tricks.